Today we're going to be tearing down the Google Pixel Pro XL to see if the cameras underneath this slab justify the size of that monstrosity. As we know, Google did not include a charger in the box this year, and I think that's because every single smartphone manufacturer understands that they cannot make a mobile charger better than Anker. Anker is the world's number one mobile charging brand and has been a sponsor and favorite of mine for years now. They've just released their Anker Prime line, aiming to become the heart and backbone of your desktop. I've been using it for a few weeks now. They have a 250 watt desktop mounted charging station. There's four USB-C ports on the front and two USB ports on the side, with a slick little smart power control dial that allows you to view detailed information like charging status and the charging speed of the different ports, along with setting charging priority. The one most useful to me though is probably the 14-port Anker Prime docking station, mostly because it brings all the USB ports from behind my computer to on top of my desk. There's 160 watts worth of USB charging, as well as a 10 gigabit per second transfer speed. And if you need power on the go, we have this power bank right here with two USB ports on the side capable of outputting 65 watts. With the flip out wall plug, it can be used as both a power bank and a wall charger, and those 65 watts are more than even the Pixel 9 Pro XL can handle. If you're ready to simplify and upgrade your desktop setup, I will leave a link down in the description for all of these Anker Prime charging stations. Anker has some sweet deals lining up with their launch, and all that info will be down in the video description. The design is so audibly satisfying, it's worth every penny. And hopefully, this Google Pixel 9 Pro XL will still charge once we're done with it.
Getting inside the Pixel 9 Pro is actually surprisingly easy. This time around, I dripped some isopropyl alcohol over the back glass panel, hoping that some of the solvent would seep into the crack between the glass slab and the aluminum frame, to help dissolve that strong glue under the slab without me having to insert my razor blade where it doesn't belong. And it worked incredibly well. The heat, alcohol, and strong suction cup pull away the glass from the phone almost all by itself. Previously, the Google lineup of phones were some of the best looking phones internally on the planet, but at first glance, this time around, here in 2024, not only is it kinda bland, but it's also using less common T4 screws around the cameras and charging port boards. This is unfortunate and makes repairability more complex than it needs to be. I'll remove 5 screws around the bottom of the Pixel 9 Pro XL, and 7 visible screws up at the top, with a few more hidden screws concealed under random pieces of black tape. There's also a considerable amount of small annoying little brackets throughout this teardown. Not as egregious as an iPhone, of course, but Google is copying Apple in the wrong direction. The back glass is pretty simple, just has the metal camera lens protruding up through the slab. The most annoying part though of this teardown is that nearly none of the screws are the same sizes, which makes reassembly super difficult if they aren't kept organized during the teardown. One sneeze and it's all over. The 23 watt wireless charging pad has copper coils round around inside. These wires are all the same diameter, where Samsung's coils increase in thickness as the coil expands outward. Interesting differences. I'll unplug the battery, along with the world's largest ribbon cable. I bet someone designed this ribbon as a joke, and it accidentally made production. Pop this on a boat and sail around the world. The strangeness of the ribbons doesn't stop there either. The other ribbon running over the battery is actually screwed into place. I imagine they ran the signal wires that we normally see as standalone colored wires into this ribbon, and the screws help maintain a good connection with the lower board, but still rather strange. I'll pop out the SIM card tray. We'll see if I damage the microphone hole during the durability test here in a second. Now, the battery removal situation is pretty much the worst. Even Apple has a better removal system in place, and that's saying something. The pull tab, and I'm using that description generously, has a website listed on it, but that website doesn't actually lead to a manual or instructions on how to remove the battery. Very unlike the Surface Pro, whose links actually worked. The glue is too strong to allow the strap to slice through it, and too strong for the tab to lift up the battery all by itself. So it's back to alcohol again to dissolve the adhesive, which is unfortunate. While that's soaking in, I'll pull out the charging port board so we can check for damage. The screen ribbon is attached to the underside, and the 37-watt USB-C port does have a gray rubber ring around the tip to help with that IP68 water resistance. You'll notice that the gold box for the microphone is mounted to the top side of the circuit board, with the receiving opening on the underside of the board. If we look at where the exterior microphone hole meets up with the interior waterproofing mesh, we can see that the membrane is located to the side of the shaft. And no matter how hard or deep the SIM tool inserts, no damage could ever possibly happen to that membrane, even with a really small tool. The exterior microphone hole is positioned right next to the SIM card tray opening, which is also where Google put their water damage indicator sticker. If this rectangle gets wet, the red coloring bleeds through onto the white, tattling that moisture has entered the phone. And obviously moisture is never covered under warranty. But to be fair, it's only when the membrane is punctured from the inside of the device that we see damage. This puncturing could also occur at depths beyond 6 feet of water though, so keep an eye out for that. Now that the alcohol has hopefully had a chance to seep under the battery, we can try to pry it out. But to no avail. This battery is glued extremely well to the body of the Pixel 9 Pro XL, making it very difficult to repair, and even more difficult to recycle at the end of its life. The Google Pixel 9 Pro XL officially has the most difficult battery to take out of any of the mainstream phones, including iPhones. Sad day for Google. From a repairability standpoint, I cannot recommend this phone to anyone. With enough alcohol and prying, I was able to remove the 5,060 mAh battery without exploding, but it's unfair to humanity to manufacture 10 million of these devices at this level of difficulty. No bueno. The lower loudspeaker does have balls inside of its blue window, and a decent-sized haptic vibrator motor positioned right above the ultrasonic fingerprint scanner. Taking another page straight from Apple's playbook, there is a standoff screw on the bottom right of the motherboard, just another unfortunate level of complexity for repair. There's another bracket up top, which hides a ribbon cable, another screw, and another bracket, all to get to the motherboard. With the camera still attached, we can see that the 50 megapixel main camera lens does have optical image stabilization. The middle 48 megapixel wide-angle camera does not have OIS. The 48 megapixel 5x telephoto camera does have OIS, it's just hidden internally. I'm always torn between destroying things to see how they work and keeping them alive. Let me know what you'd like to see more of down in the comments. But it's looking like these camera units are all large enough and take up enough real estate to justify the extra large camera lens. The gigantic outer pane of glass is not just for show. Under the motherboard is a moist layer of thermal foam. This helps move the heat from the AI processing to the frame of the phone and then spread by the copper vapor chamber to dissipate out through the screen. And speaking of out through the screen, the backside of the motherboard has its proximity and light sensors that peek out through the pixels of the phone. You can see the light from my flashlight shining through the pixels into the little square that they're able to peek through. Kinda cool. Thumbs up for that. The last quirky thing I notice is that the main camera units, while they all look connected in a giant bar, are actually clipped modularly into place like little Legos. It's not one permanent box. I wonder if this helps improve the assembly process. Different cameras can be clipped together while manufacturing, since the cameras vary between the Pixel 9 and the Pixel 9 Pro. Only the Pro has the third telephoto module clipped in. I'll have to tear down a 9 to see if this is true or not, but honestly, I'm kinda disappointed. Google seems to be going backward when it comes to repairability, and that's just really too bad. They get on stage and talk a big game about the environment, but in reality, they just made another 10 million devices that can't be fixed or recycled easily, and I hope that people vote with their wallets. Both Samsung and Apple have made massive changes recently to improve their repairability, and if Google should be copying one thing from the other players, it definitely shouldn't be the brackets or proprietary screws. These phones don't last forever. Lucky for us though, mine is indeed still alive, and if you want to see the insides of your phone from the outsides without taking it apart, I'll leave a link for my teardown skin down in the description. And for the ultimate test, plugging in the Pixel 9 Pro XL into the Anker Prime power bank with an impressive 240 watt charging cable, we are indeed still juicing up. Grab yours down below, and thanks a ton for watching. I'll see you around.